Welcome to day four of Advent in a series that we're calling Emmanuel, God with us, where we're looking at why Jesus came and what Jesus came to do and what Jesus comes to do. Today we're looking at how Jesus comes to bless the nations. So we're looking at Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you." And over into the New Testament, into the book of Acts, chapter 3, verses 17 to 25. "Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. Heaven must receive him until the time comes for God to restore everything as he has promised long ago through his holy prophets. For Moses said, 'The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You must listen to everything he tells you. Anyone who does not listen to him will be completely cut off from their people.' Indeed, beginning with Samuel, all the prophets who had spoken have foretold these days, and you are heirs of the prophets and of the covenant God made with your fathers. He said to Abraham, 'Through your offspring, all peoples on earth will be blessed.' When God raised up his servant, he sent him first to you to bless you by turning each of you from your wicked ways." And then further in the New Testament, in Galatians chapter 3, verses 7 to 29. "Understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announced the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed, along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. As it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law.' Clearly, no one who relies on the law is justified before God, because the righteous will live by faith. The law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says the person who does these things will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole.' He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Brothers and sisters, let me take an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or add to a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. Scripture just does not say, 'and to seeds,' meaning many people, but 'and to your seed,' meaning one person, who is Christ. What I mean is this: the law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God, and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. But God, in his grace, gave it to Abraham through a promise. Why then was the law given at all? It was added because of transgressions, until the seed to whom the promise referred had come. The law was given through angels and entrusted to a mediator. A mediator, however, implies then more than one party, but God is one. Is the law therefore opposed to the promises of God? Absolutely not. For if a law had been given that could impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. But Scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin, so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe. Before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until the faith that was to come would be revealed. So the law was our guardian until Christ came, that we might be justified by faith. Now that this faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Amen. It got me thinking as I was reading through those passages for today, where we think about how, especially in today's culture with social media, and we get to choose who we listen to, we get to choose which news outlets we pay attention to, we get to choose who we follow on Twitter or Instagram, and it can become this kind of echo chamber where all we're doing is reflecting back on ourselves, other people who think and act and look and feel exactly the same way as we do, just to kind of bolster up what we already believe. And when everyone's dressed the same, when they look the same and sound the same, and when they agree with you on everything, it can make life seem easy because it makes me feel right, and it makes anyone who is not like me feel wrong. When our lives are uncontested, it becomes increasingly certain that things are the way that they should be. And as long as I can prop up the way I think things should be going and the things that I hold as important, as long as those can be going in the upward direction, then life is good. But that's not what's promised here, is it? I think that's similarly what's being dealt with these Jewish converts to Christianity. In the decades that followed Jesus's life, I can imagine why it would have been really difficult for them as a group of people, as a community, to accept God's promises might include other people that don't look like them, that don't act like them, that don't sound and dress like them, that don't think like them, people from outside of their fold. The Jewish people were, as far as they were concerned, they were the offspring of Abraham. He was Father Abraham, the father of their nation. They were one big family. And they were adherents to the law of Moses as well. And now, all of a sudden, in come all these other groups of people who aren't from their tribe and don't look like them. And they can become part of God's people, as far as they were concerned, by converting to Judaism, doing exactly what they do, acting exactly like they act, being exactly like they are, ultimately turning themselves into more of them. But that's not what goes on here, is it? See, after Jesus, through the ministries of people like Paul, who wrote Galatians, God's promises were suddenly extended and opened out to the nations, it says over and over again in the Bible, doesn't it? And that means what? It means the nations. It means everyone, everywhere, without adding to all of these, the ceremony and the tradition and the rituals of Judaism. I wonder what that felt like for those original Jewish converts. To be told that Gentiles, these outsiders, these people who, as far as they were concerned, for thousands of years now were the enemy, people who were so, so different from them, who saw the world in such different ways and had so many different cultural issues and things going on themselves, for those Jews to look at those people and no longer realise that they were the top of the pile, they were first in line. Think how scandalous that would have been, that message, when Paul first started to talk about these kinds of things and write these kinds of letters. That these group of people saw themselves as in the right. These people were the children of God. It was their inheritance. And now all of these other people were being welcomed in to take it from them. That's what they'd have seen it like. It was being taken from them, not shared, but stolen. And it makes me think about our lives today and how we view things, like I said at the beginning, with social media and that kind of stuff. And what kind of echo chambers are we creating for ourselves? Are we only associating with people who look like us and sound like us and think like us and dress like us and act like us? Or are we embracing this all-expansive openness of the gospel that is for all of the nations? So as we celebrate the miracle of God taking on flesh at this time of the year, let us remember that we are all invited to this kingdom of God. What would it mean for the maturity of our own individual faith to believe that God's promises are available for everyone, just as much as they're available to us? See, God's plan has always been for those who love him and live by faith. That verse again, Galatians 3:26. In Christ, we are all children of God through faith. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that our identity isn't found in our kind of human families, our surnames. Our identity isn't found in where we grew up or where we live now. Our identity isn't found in the clothes that we wear or the music we listen to or the jobs that we go to or the other people that we hang around with. Our identity isn't found in any of that other stuff. That our identity is found in you and you alone. God, help us, particularly at this time in Advent, to be aware of all the ways that perhaps in the past we have closed this good news, this gospel message off to others because they don't look like us. They don't act like us. They don't feel like us. They don't think like us. Help us to remember that this gospel is bigger than that. That your good news is bigger than that. Jesus, help us to release this message upon everyone, because this is for all the nations. Amen. Grace and peace.